You're listening to Scalae Sisters, episode number 74. Welcome to Scalae Sisters, the podcast for the classical homeschooling mama who seeks to learn and grow while she's helping her children learn and grow. Scalae Sisters is a casual conversation about topics that matter to those of us in the trenches of classical homeschooling who yearn for something more than just checking boxes and getting it all done. I'm your host, Brandi Fensel. You can find me over at afterthoughtsblog.net, blogging my thoughts on Charlotte Mason and homeschooling and hawking my study guides and more in the shop. My co-hosts today are Misty Winkler and Abby Wall. Misty is a second-generation homeschooler with 5 kids and too many projects. With her blog, podcast, and membership, she helps you organize your attitude so you can organize your life. Find her over at simplyconvivial.com. Abby is basically the queen of the Scalae Sisters sistership. Abby is a country-living farmer rancher, a loving wife, and mom of 5 who homeschools and reads whenever she can. We have a special treat for you today. If you head over to scalaesisters.com/guide, you can download for free our new beginner's guide to Scalae. If you are not a beginner, you still might like it, but even more important is that we've set it up where you can share it. That's right. You know all those friends you've been trying to share Scalae with? This is the resource you've been waiting for, our gift to you. Today's episode is all about the fall retreat. In the first half, we talk about COVID and lockdown and how to manage a retreat if we're still on lockdown when it happens, including what we plan to do to help support unique situations. In the second half, we talk about how we overhauled part of our program to make room for something super special from Abby. You're going to want to hear all about it. And so, without further ado, let's get to it. Since we are not doing a Scalae every day, because this is a summer episode, we will just start right off with what is actually, it is the first thing on our list. Look at us, so organized. So we are talking about retreats and handling a retreat in the time of COVID. A lot of our listeners are probably in states that are open, but I'm sure a lot of them are also in states that aren't, because it looks like some of the most populated states are not open. So we need to talk about, if we hit October and people are still under lockdown or partial lockdown, things might look a little different.
Yes. The thing is, we just don't know. And so it's better to not try to predict.
Right.
Almost.
Or plan for the worst case scenario, maybe.
Right. Because who knows how the winter season and adding other stuff in will affect decisions people make.
Right. Yes. Plus, I mean, you could be somewhere where people, even if your state isn't limiting you, people are limiting you because they have their own concerns. So there's that. Right. There's like the social issues too. So,
yes. And you know what? It's just, I think that right now more than ever, we do know how important community is because now we've been lacking it for a while.
Oh, yeah.
And so I just really think that this year for the retreats, it's going to be important to connect with your people, even if it's not in person, even if it's your local people, but you have to use Zoom. And I know at this point, many of us are Zoomed out, but
yep,
still, it helps us process and apply when we are learning alongside other people and not just us and our computer screen. If you are able to meet in person, I think it's a great time to plan for a small intimate group instead of large gatherings. There were quite a few retreats in the last couple of years that have been big gatherings. And those are fun and a lot of energy, extra energy. But coming out of a time of quarantine, not only are larger groups going to have more restrictions, but in a smaller group, you can connect better. Everyone gets a chance to talk. It's just more intimate and relational. And I think that this year, especially, that's really important.
So if someone belongs to a large homeschool community that has been doing retreats together, then what's your advice for that?
I think it'd be a good plan to have breakout groups instead of one large one, quite honestly. You know, church buildings and all that will probably also have extra restrictions they have to add, where it might be a burden to them to host groups because of the, you know, hygiene and space requirement uses. But if we had groups of, you know, 4, 5, 6 ladies just in our homes, in our backyards with a laptop propped up, you know, October, it depends on where you are in the country, whether or not that's workable in October. But I think that would be friendship building in a really important way this year.
Yeah. Well, and it's hospitality, right?
Right. Adding that element. Homes, yeah.
What a better way to think about healing than, you know, a hospital. So hospitality is like a refreshing or, you know, it's a place where you go to get well, hopefully.
Right. I like that.
So if things are still not healthy for, you know, the nation or your state or things like that, or there's still a lot of concern, then, you know, we can open our homes to a few people and limit exposure if that's, you know, necessary. And we can build one another up and come out healthier.
Yeah.
I love that hospital imagery. Okay. Then let's say someone, they can't meet at all. The small group thing isn't going to work. Whatever reason, legal restriction, church restriction, personal restrictions, whatever.
Location restriction. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Whatever. There could be a bazillion reasons for it. So then how do they still connect?
So one of the things we're going to do differently this year is provide Zoom breakout rooms for groups. And this is only if you do the retreat live on the weekend where we're doing this. So on October 10th, if you want your group to use that time between sessions to discuss and meet and chat, then we're going to provide that format and the link and everything so that you don't have to administer Zoom, but you can have that link and still have your own personal group. So it's not a huge room full of brand new faces, but it is a group that either you've put together or we can also break people up if you want to talk to some other ladies and you don't have anyone to connect with. We can connect you to a small group breakout room between the sessions so that you can kind of do that processing and applying and discussion in between.
And if I hate Zoom, then I can use Voxer.
Yes. Just set yourself up a little Voxer channel.
Or Marco Polo or whatever it is people are using.
Right. Whatever your friends use. I think that's a great option. And, you know, maybe Voxer with your friends, just arrange to do that yourself. That'd be a great option too, because you could get out and get steps in between sessions.
Ooh. I like that idea.
But yeah, I think it's a time where we need to expand out of the isolation. It's been enforced on us, and it can be easy, especially for introverts, to just say, you know what, this isn't so bad. And I could just be me and my computer, and that's actually okay. You know, we do need friendships. And so we want to encourage people to still reach out and maintain those friendships and to have people that they can talk about ideas with and a community and friends that you're learning with that you know you're not alone. And it also just helps to learn and to think deeply when you have people to talk about it with.
Well, and when you're, if you can meet in person, even in a small group, it changes the dynamic, right? If we are able to, I think that's the best option. If you can't, by all means, try and check up on your extroverted friends, because as the meme says, they are not doing okay. And they need you. So have pity on your extroverted friends, right? But, you know, when you have a computer screen, even though you can see them, it's still a barrier. You are not in the same place as them. And so it definitely, it's not the same. So if you can meet in person, there is something that just changes, right? It's just, you are able to talk more freely and you are not worried about what you look like because you can't see yourself. And so you're less self-conscious. I do think that that's a problem. I think like looking at your face,
right.
you're worrying about it. And then you notice you're touching your face and you're like, oh my gosh. And so you never really get outside of yourself if you have to look at yourself. And so when you are in a room with people, we are able to get more of that school A type feeling because we get to be self-forgetful. Zoom meetings are not always the best bet. Voxer, you don't have to see yourself either. So, but
but yeah, local is, it's different yeah. to be really face-to-face. And so one of the things we're going to do to help promote even those smaller groups meeting up, you know, a group is even two people.
Yes.
So if you grab a friend and you can do it together in person, then you get the group discount. We aren't going to have a size requirement to get that group discount for those people who are able to meet in person together.
And Brandy's going to make invitations. Aren't you, Brandy?
Yes, I am. I had forgotten I said that I was doing that, but I am going to do that.
So you can download some invitations for your group, or you can make them online, or you can send them in an email, or you can print them out. And Brandy has a wonderful eye for those things. And so she's going to make some really great invitations for you.
Yes, I am.
I'm looking forward to seeing the graphic for this year because they're always surprising.
It'll be the little Scole sisters head bust with not sunglasses, but
a COVID mask. I should change our Facebook page.
You're welcome.
Actually, you should have both though.
Yes, you should.
You could look like a secret shopper.
That's hilarious. Another thing that we are going to do a little bit differently is the group leaders will have the option of either collecting payment at the door from the people who are able to come and then submitting an invoice afterwards, which is how we've been doing it, or inviting their friends to just register themselves online and just keep all the payment part digital and not have to worry about the invoicing afterwards. Some people were fine with that, and some people that was an extra burden. So we can make that work either way this year.
So how will they know the option? I mean, is there like a place they go to figure that out, or?
So if you're a group leader and you want to invite your friends to meet with you either in person or you want to do one of the Zoom breakout rooms, then you contact us and we give you a group discount code for your group. And then you pass that along and the discount code can go on the invitation. And then when you purchase it, you'll also receive a certificate of purchase, which is another thing Brandy's going to make.
I have an amazing to-do list, you guys. The longer we record, the longer it gets. So I'm itching to get out of here. So when they decide they want to do a group, go to schoolasisters.com/leaders. Then you'll find the form that you can use to apply to lead a local group. And on the form, you can check a box or something like that. There will be a way for you to indicate whether you want to do invoicing or whether you would prefer to just have everybody pay online and show up having already paid.
Yes.
So you will be able to answer that question when you fill out your form.
Yes.
And we'll take care of the rest.
Yep, we will.
We meaning Misty.
We're really helpful.
We really are.
But now let's talk about what Abby is going to do with the retreat. Yes,
because we are not done until everybody has a to-do list. Yes. So we, in the past, have always had the final session be a Q&A session. And while that is lovely, a lot of people have felt like they weren't done. They didn't feel a sense of completion. And so we have been brainstorming about what to do about that. And so we're pulling the Q&A session and replacing it with Abby magic. So Abby, why don't you tell us what you're doing?
Well, for closing ceremonies.
Wow, so fancy.
Yes. No, I think you nailed it right there. It doesn't feel quite finished. It feels like, but wait, I wanted to talk more. And then everybody has to leave. Also, it just feels very like you're spent. You know, you've sat there and been taking so many great thoughts and ideas in, and there's just so much to think about and it's all swirling around. And then there's more questions being asked. And then all of a sudden you're like, okay, and goodbye. And
great.
I've been to a local group a few times with Danielle Cyrus, who she's been on one of the episodes about it. Oh, and she does a phenomenal job, but even so we have to clean up and get out of there. And she connects with a lot of her group because they're in a co-op together. But I'm pretty much done after that. So I don't always get to talk about all the things I've learned. And I don't know about you, but at the end of a conference or a retreat, which I've only ever been to one homeschool conference with Misty. So I can't really speak to a lot of the other ones. But there's just so much going on. And the last thing I want to do is write down notes or, you know, write down my thoughts afterwards. I just kind of want to like veg. And usually you're around a lot of people. And so the introvert that I am, I just want to have some quiet, which isn't always possible. So closing ceremonies, or what we're going to call it, is actually a contemplation session. And we wanted it to sound super smart and intellectual, which is why we're calling it that. But what it actually is just a place where we can sit with our thoughts and force ourselves to write down the things that we want to remember, the ideas that really struck us, and hopefully come up with some ways that we can faithfully apply what we learned to our own homes and homeschools. I've been reading a great book called An Everlasting Meal by Tamar Adler. And she was just talking about cooking. And I thought this really related to it, but it's, you know, cooking is learned by doing. You know, we need to taste, smell, and to look. We need to, you know, use temperature gauges and timers. But, and this is her quote, only by tasting can you learn to connect the decisions you make with their outcomes. And so a contemplation session is going to be this learning by doing. So we are going to sit and think about what we've done, and we're going to write those things out and really focus in on our own families and our own lives, right? To go back to the cooking analogy, you know, no matter how well a cookbook is written, the cooking times will be a little bit off. Ingredients sometimes don't take 3 to 5 minutes, right? Or sometimes they're 10 minutes to be done. You know, it depends on the day or the stove or the, you know, quality of the ingredients, right? And just like a talk or a lecture or a wonderful online retreat, no matter how well it is delivered, it won't be a perfect fit for your situation or an exact match to, you know, our own families or life. There will be, of course, some similarities, but there are different dynamics in family culture, and we need to take into account the personalities of the individuals, right? The born persons in our homes. That is why we need time to apply faithfully and to notice our own thoughts and make those connections. Just as you are the expert in your kitchen, you are the expert of your life and family. No one else apart from God knows the unique needs and circumstances. Charlotte Mason talks about a lesson isn't finished right until it is assimilated.
Right. That's why we narrate.
And so this is a way that we can narrate after the lessons. That's one of the other things in Charlotte Mason education, right? You are to do it very closely to when you heard it. As time goes on, we forget more and more if we don't narrate. We have school A sheets that when you listen to podcast episodes, you know, you can narrate and write down those things. But, you know, when you're listening to a podcast, I don't know about you, but I'm usually out on a walk, probably don't have a notebook in hand, or, you know, I haven't printed off the sheet, you know, so it just doesn't happen. But I know that when I read something or listen to something, and then after I write down what I've learned, or at least the things I want to remember, it stays with me forever. Or I end up telling people more and more about the things that I actually wrote down. So
it's really building Scholae time into the Scholae retreat.
Yes.
Imagine that.
We're, you know, preaching and practicing. No, practicing, but not really preaching. Please know that. But yeah, so often we consume past the point of retention, right? You know, even looking at our notes later, we can't quite decipher our own disjointed or partial thoughts. You know, and if the material was live, there isn't a way where we can go back and re-listen. And even when we do have an audio replay, it's not always easy to make time to go over the material again, right? There's always new stuff coming out. So while we have some of the great ideas swirling around in our heads, it, you know, it doesn't necessarily translate into actionable items. It keeps our brains full. And then because it isn't anchored, we forget and move on to the next thing. We know what we learned was a value, but the value is temporary and it doesn't compel us to act differently, which, you know, is that high form of learning. So that's why we need to spend some time processing what we're learning. And we need to reproduce, you know, the things that we're learning. And we need to practice that art of narration. I practice it with my kids, but we probably don't do it as often as we should. You know, when I'm just reading for myself, I'm lazy. I'm a lazy narrator. So, you know, we have to stop being happy and content to passively listening, you know, instead of trying to do that active applying. We need time and space to sit, think, and contemplate. So contemplation sessions were born.
So we're carving it out.
Yep.
In advance.
Yep. We need the space for our brains to pause and make connections. And we need to stop just consuming and we need to start digesting so that we have the energy to create, produce, and live, right? We don't want to be info junkies or gluttons of more and more information. You know, we want to take the ideas and principles and apply them to our own circumstances. We don't just want to copy and paste someone else's life. And that doesn't work anyway.
So this is a tall order.
Yeah.
But you're going to lead this. So people don't have to put that kind of pressure on themselves. We're just putting the pressure on you.
Yes.
Okay, good. Just making sure.
Yep. So it's kind of going to be, you know, I will have some guided questions and I will have some quotes that help prompt us. But there's going to be some awkward silence, which is so painful to do. You know, we're so, you know, anytime it's quiet, you know, what do? Pick up our phones or go look something up. You know, when's the last time you just sat without earbuds in outside and enjoyed nature, right? Like those are things that have to be intentionally done. Like I have to purposely leave my phone away, you know? So I know that there will be people that are tempted to be like, oh, I don't really need this. I can see that happening. Like, well, this isn't really helping me in anything. But I think people will be surprised how much time and space does help them retain and make those connections.
Mm-hmm. So are you intending for people to discuss? Or are you intending for them to come ready to write and think on their own?
I'm hoping that everyone will have paper and some sort of pen and that they can actually write down these things. And then hopefully afterwards, their groups can discuss the practice, right? How did it go, right? Did they struggle with this and troubleshoot through those things? I think that's when it's great to have feedback.
Oh, so this is a good thought when we're talking about the schedule, just like how all the other sessions have some space afterwards for discussion, they should probably allow for that after your session too, right?
Yes.
Okay.
That's a good point.
Yes, because before we need to hear other people's thoughts and opinions, we should be, you know, listening to, I don't know if we want to call it the still small voice, but like we actually need to think about our own thoughts and opinions. You know, a lot of people have a lot of great things to say, but sometimes we hear what other people say and it's articulated well. And we're like, oh yeah, that was great. And then we forget our own points, right? So we just need that space to think about it for ourselves.
Yeah. Well, I'm excited.
Yeah. I think it's going to add that feeling of closure and just making that space for thinking, because it's so easy to just go on to the next thing and not take the time and the silence to think a whole thought about it.
Yeah. So if someone's bummed that we're cutting the Q&A session, like they really liked that part for some reason, they can still send questions, right? I mean, we could still do something.
Last year, we did a bonus. Like a
follow-up, right?
Yeah.
We did a bonus.
Q&A session.
Yeah, you can send all your questions to me and I will put Brandy and Pam and Misty, I'll put them in the hot seat.
Abby@schoolasisters.com. You can also send complaints there.
No, you can't send any complaints. I accept no hate mail.
Okay, fair enough.
My feelings can't handle them.
That's right.
Send it to Brandy instead and she'll laugh.
That's right.
That's true. I'll be like, you have a point. Delete. Well, anything else?
Yeah, I think it's just remembering that it's time to start thinking about that and figuring out what's going to work for your life, where you're at right now, and how and when and where you can gather with a couple friends and think some great thoughts and share those with each other and learn. And I'm just really excited about this year's topic.
Yeah, I am too.
Love and all of the different, it's just connected to every little thing. There's no way we're going to, I want to say extinguish is the wrong word.
Exhaust.
Exhaust. Thank you. There's no way we're going to exhaust that topic, but we're coming at it from a few different angles and we'll talk more about that the next summer bonus episode.
If you want to lead a group, even if it's just you and one other person, then you can go to the leaders page, which is schoolasisters.com/leaders. And the first thing it'll ask you to do is fill out the form. And the form is where you'll inquire about leading a group. And that's where you get on our leaders list. So you get all the information that you need in order to put a group together, right?
Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
All right. I think we're done then.
Okay, good.
Thanks, Brandy. This was great. I am really looking forward to this retreat.
I am too.
That's it for today. Thank you so much for listening and being a part of the sisterhood of the podcast. Make sure you're subscribed so you don't miss the next episode of our brief summer bonus season. Don't forget that the Beginner's Guide to School A is ready for you to enjoy and to share with your friends. Just head on over to schoolasisters.com/guide to get your copy or share a copy. In our next episode, all of the sisters, that's right, me, Abby, Pam, Misty, we'll all be together and we're going to be with this year's retreat guest speaker, the one and only Karen Glass. This year's retreat theme is Loving Well, and the whole episode is going to be us kind of discussing the topic and the angle we're going to take on it, what we have planned for that day. It's going to be a lot of fun. Until then, we want to remind you once again that homeschooling is a marathon. You needn't run alone, so open up your eyes and look around you. Find your sisters.
Oh, yes, we can hear you. Hello, hello.
Yes. Can you say something, Misty, so I can hear you?
Yep. Yep. Can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Yep.
All right.
That's a good idea. I didn't know that. This is great news.
I just made that up.
That's awesome. So apparently I'm now making custom invitations.